Well, I've essentially already read for you our text, but let me just repeat the one verse we're going to be looking at in Romans chapter 11, verse 36. Paul writes this, he says, "For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen." This is what we want to focus on this morning. Now, last week, we saw where our strength as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ actually comes from. It comes from the Lord, of course. The psalmist writes in Psalm 84, verse 5, "How blessed is the man whose strength is in you." But we do need to realize that what the psalmist was talking about here was not physical strength, although we know that the Lord certainly is the source of that as well. After all, he was the one who gave strength to the strongest man who ever lived, and I think we would all agree that that was Samson, at least physically, to execute his judgments upon the Philistines. God was the one who gave to David's mighty men the power and the strength that they had to defeat armies. He is the one who gives to us the strength that we need every day to do what he calls us to do physically. But again, that's not what the psalmist was referring to. What he was talking about here was spiritual strength, a strength which actually comes from love. He explained this in his next statement. He says, again in verse 5, "How blessed is the man in whose heart are the highways to Zion." We understand by this that when the Lord gave us his Holy Spirit, he created a love in our hearts for him, a love that gives us strength because it draws us out to him. It drives us, as a matter of fact. What you love dictates the direction that you will go. I think we all know that by experience. And the strength of that love determines the effort that you're actually going to put out in order to gain that thing that you love. Whatever you love the most controls your life. Well, you know what? God wants that control. And if he is to have it, then you must love him the most. Now, we also saw that if you love him the most, as I've said, it's going to draw you out to him. You're going to want to be near him. Like Paul, you're going to want to be the most where it is that the Lord reveals himself the most, and that is in heaven. So love for the Lord will, as it were, draw you out towards heaven. That will be your destination. That is going to be the way you want to go. Since you can't be with the Lord right now, because we know that death is the only thing that stands in the way, and death is something that is entirely in his hands, love for the Lord will draw you out to the next best place where he reveals himself, and that is in public worship. That's where you're going to want to be in order that you may seek him and give him glory. But again, since you can't meet with him every day in public worship, since this is something we essentially do once a week on the Lord's Day, at least publicly, I mean, I suppose what we do on Wednesdays could also be categorized as worship. Since we can't do it every day, we will try to seek him again where he is found, and that would be on the road where he is pleased to reveal himself, the path of obedience. You'll seek to walk with him in that path every day. As a matter of fact, that is going to be key to what we're looking at this morning, which is giving glory to him, as well as what we're going to look at this evening, which is the pleasure that we should have when we actually are walking with him. Because what is more pleasurable than being close to the one that you love the most? Well, there are other reasons, of course, that you'll want to walk on this path of obedience. You will, because certainly this is how you can be near to the Lord. But you'll also want to walk on it because, as I've just said, this is how you can give him glory. And this is how you can find pleasure. The greatest pleasure, actually, that you can experience in the world. Now, that's what we want to look at today. This morning, we'll want to consider that we will walk in this path that brings us near to God, the path of obedience. We'll live this kind of life that pleases Him because we will want to give Him glory, which is essentially what the Lord created us for. Again, I would remind you what Paul writes in Romans 11:36, "For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be the glory forever. Amen." Now, what I'd like us to do is simply in a few moments to consider what this glory is. What does Paul mean when he says, "To Him be the glory"? Secondly, why we should give God glory. And thirdly, and perhaps most importantly, how we can do this. Now, Paul reminds us of something I think we all know very well, and that is that God made everything that there is. And God is behind everything that has happened in the world, everything that is happening in the world, and everything that will happen. And perhaps more importantly, God has done all these things for a particular reason. Now, what is that reason? What is God's purpose behind all these things? Well, Paul essentially tells us here the reason that he did all these things was for his glory. Now, to understand this, we first need to know what Paul means by glory. What is it? Well, when we talk about glory in connection with God, it can really mean one of two things. First of all, it can refer to the way that God appears when He reveals Himself, some kind of visible manifestation to His radiance, to His brightness. We read in Ezekiel 10, verse 4, one example where He revealed Himself in this way. It says this, "Then the glory of the Lord went up from the cherub in the threshold of the temple, and the temple was filled with the cloud, and the court was filled with the brightness of the glory of the Lord." Here, this brightness, or at least this glory, is said to be something that is bright, something that can be seen. It is this radiance from God. Now, it's also interesting to note that this is exactly what the Apostle Paul saw before he was the Apostle Paul, when he was the Pharisee Saul on his way to Damascus in order to arrest Christians, bring them back to Jerusalem for trial and for execution. He says in his testimony to King Agrippa in Acts 26, verses 12 through 15, "While so engaged, as I was journeying to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests, at midday, O king," that is when the sun would be at its brightest, "I saw on the way a light from heaven brighter than the sun, shining all around me and those who were journeying with me. And when we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew dialect, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads.' And I said, 'Who are you, Lord?' And the Lord said, 'I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting.'" Glory in connection with God can first of all refer to this radiant effulgence of God's splendor and majesty, something visible, something that can be seen. But glory is also something that refers to God's reputation, to the credit that He deserves, to the honor and the praise that we are to give Him for what He has done. I believe this is what Paul is talking about in our passage. He says, "To Him be the glory forever." He is the one who deserves all the praise, all the honor from now until the end of time. And when you stop and think about it, this visible glory of God is something that God basically has in and of Himself. It's a part of His being. It adorns His being and His presence. It's not something that we can give Him. It's not something we can add to. But we can give Him this. We can give Him glory. We can give Him honor. We can give Him credit. We can, as it were, declare what He is worthy of. That has to do with His reputation. Now, the second question we should ask is this: why should God have this glory? Why should he have this honor? Well, Paul actually tells us in our passage, he basically says two things. First of all, because God is the one who has done everything. I mean, who is the one who deserves the credit except the one who actually does it? But he also tells us, secondly, because this is why he did what he did, so that he would receive this credit, this glory, this honor. Now, first of all, Paul tells us that God is the one who has done everything. Again, in Romans 11, 36. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Now, what does he mean by all things? Well, all things includes, of course, everything that there is. Everything God created, everything he does in his creation, and of course, that most particular thing that interests us that he did in the creation, which is the work of redemption. Why should God receive glory? Well, first of all, he's the one who created everything that exists. Moses writes in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. John writes in John 1, verses 1 through 3, that it was a specific person of the Godhead who actually created all things. And as a matter of fact, it's the same one who took upon himself human flesh and tabernacled among us, the one who pitched his tent among us, the Lord Jesus Christ. He says in John 1, beginning in verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. I want you to notice it says all things came through him. It's not like the Father used Jesus as a conduit in which to do his work, but through him means that he is the one who actually did it. He is the agent, the active cause, the one who spoke, and all things were done. Actually, if we take Sinclair Ferguson's definition, which is likely the case, the Father speaks. What he speaks is the Word. The Word is with God. The Word is God. The Word is the one who tabernacles among us. And that creative Word comes forth and basically is the Spirit of God hovering over the creation, receives this Word from the Lord. He is the active agent there as well. So we see all three persons involved in creation. God created all things. And when he created all things, he created absolutely everything. Not only the things that can be seen, but also the things that can't be seen. God didn't create, or Jesus didn't create, all that there is out of perhaps some invisible stuff that was hanging around somewhere. He made all things visible and invisible in that creative act, everything physical and spiritual. Paul writes in Colossians 1, verses 16 through 17, for by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the absolute creator of all things. That's why he should receive glory. He's the one who upholds everything. We actually just read a couple of passages that had to do with that. He not only made it, but he's the one who continues to keep it in existence. This may be a little bit of a technical point, but once God creates something, it doesn't have sort of an independent existence from him. It can't just continue to exist apart from him. The Lord is the one who must exert, as it were, his divine power to keep it in existence. And that's exactly what he does for this creation. He is the one who keeps it in being. The author to the Hebrews writes in Hebrews 1, verse 3, again referring to Jesus, he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature and upholds all things by the word of his power. That word uphold means to keep it in existence, but it also means to bear it along. He's the one who moves everything along according to the plan of God, which is also what Paul writes about in Ephesians 1:11. Also, we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. Why should we give glory to God? Because he not only created, but he continues to keep everything in existence, and he moves it along according to his plan. And then thirdly, and perhaps most importantly for us this morning, he is the one who, when Adam sinned and brought all of his children, as well as the whole creation, under the curse of the broken covenant of works, he is the one who sent his Son into the world to redeem the creation, to redeem us through the Lord Jesus Christ. I hope you know the work of Jesus Christ includes not only the redemption of his people, but it includes the redemption of his whole creation. The whole creation fell under the curse, and Jesus is the one who frees the entire creation from it, so that Paul says in Romans chapter 8, the creation itself is groaning like pangs of a woman in childbirth, desiring to be set free from the corruption that it's under. Jesus is the one who sets it free. That's what Paul writes in Colossians 1, verses 19 and 20. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven. The whole creation is redeemed in the Lord Jesus. Now, we don't see the redemption of the creation yet, just like we don't see it in ourselves, because we too are also groaning within ourselves, longing to be set free from the corruption that we are under, and we will be set free when Jesus comes again. He will set us free. He will set this creation free. So why should God receive the glory? Well, it's because he created. It's because he upholds all things. It's because he moves it all along according to his plans. Because he is the author of salvation. He is the one who, after the creation was fallen under the curse and we were, sent his Son into the world to redeem us. Now I want you to notice again in our text, Paul says that all these things are from him. He is the source. He says that they are all through him. He is the agent, the one who has done all these things. And then for our purposes this morning, he says they are all to him. In other words, what did God have in view when he did all these things? They were all unto him. He is the goal. He is the reason for what he has done. The reason why God created all these things and did all these things was for really one purpose, and it wasn't the redemption of man. That was not center in his plan. It's essentially a part of his plan, but the overall purpose for which God did all these things was for his glory. He did it to reveal his glory. What are we supposed to see when we look at what he has done in the creation? When we get out the Hubble telescope and we point it out into space and we see these billions of galaxies. You know how big our galaxy is? How many hundreds of thousands of light years across it is? And yet the universe has billions. They say 100 billion galaxies. And they say that when we perhaps get a little stronger telescope, we'll be able to see there's even more, maybe 200 billion. It may actually be more than that. What should we see when we look at the planets, when we look at the stars, when we look at the life that God has created in this world, when we look at man? I mean, even under a microscope, and we look into the cell and we see all the things that are there, and we see the DNA molecule, and we see how wonderfully all that works together as a storage, as a way of storing information, a way of utilizing information, as we see all these things, and particularly as we look at the soul of man. A moral being, an intelligent being, one who has awareness of himself, one that has purpose. What are we supposed to see? We're supposed to see the glory of God. That's the reason why God created it. We're supposed to see his wisdom. We're supposed to see his power. When we look at the vastness of the universe, we're supposed to see his greatness and his infinity. And of course, as we look at all the good things that God has made in this world, we are to see His goodness, especially in making us in His image so that we might know Him. And that is exactly what we do see. Paul writes to the church at Rome in Romans 1:20, "For since the creation of the world, that is, since He made the world, from that time forward, His invisible attributes, His eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, and not only seen, but also being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse." Everybody in the world sees the glory of God, exactly what God intended. Even well-known atheists that continually deny that God exists, they know He exists, they see Him clearly, and they have no excuse. What should we see when we look at God's providence, when we look at His plan? In His upholding and moving everything along, all the events of history, even the events in our lives according to His plan. What does God want us to see? Well, again, we should see His glory, certainly the glory of His wisdom and power and His ability to work all these things together to make them all, as it were, conspire for the growth of His kingdom. Things that seem quite contrary to what God wants to be done actually work together to advance the kingdom of heaven, the same way that our sins and difficulties and trials that we see that are contrary to the will of God, He's even able to use those to help us grow and to help us move forward. We should see in that the glory of God. And what should we see in His work of creation? Well, again, His work of redemption, we should see the glory of His grace and of His mercy. His limitless love that the Lord says He has always had for us and will show us throughout all eternity. Remember, we were His enemies, and He gave that which was most precious to Him, and that is His Son, to die for us on the cross, to become a curse for us on the cross, so that we might be set free and that we might become the children of God. He's done that for us. We should see the glory of His love, the glory of His grace and of His mercy. At the cross, by the way, we should also see the glory of His holiness, that God is a holy God, and He cannot overlook sin. That's why an adequate payment had to be made before God could forgive any sin. He is holy and He is just, and we see the glory of these things through the work of redemption. So God has done what He's done so that we might see Him, that we might come to know Him, and that knowing Him, we might glorify and honor Him for these things. And that essentially means give Him the credit, give Him the praise, give Him the worship. So glory is giving Him credit. It's giving Him honor. We should give Him this because He's the one who deserves it. He's the one who's done it all. But then finally, how can we glorify God? And we already know a little bit about that. I mean, I think we know quite a bit about this, but let's be encouraged to do it because this is why the Lord made us. This is why He redeemed us. We need to glorify God with our words. We need to glorify God in the way that we live. And let me again just point to Jesus Christ as the ultimate example of this, because who glorified God more or more perfectly than Jesus? No one. With His words and with His life, He fulfilled what it is we sang about a little bit earlier this morning when He said, "Fill Thou my life, O Lord my God, in every part with praise." That is exactly how Jesus lived. That's how He calls us to live. Jesus is our example. Now, the first and most obvious way that we can give glory to God is through our worship. That's what we're doing now. As a matter of fact, one other way just occurred to me on how we can glorify God, and that is, of course, hearing what it is He's telling us, but also speaking of Him, glorifying Him with our words. David writes in Psalm 22, verse 23, "You who fear the Lord, praise Him. All you descendants of Jacob, glorify Him. And stand in awe of Him, all you descendants of Israel." Praise and glory, essentially in parallel with one another, they're talking about the same thing. Give Him glory, give Him praise. Psalm 86:12, David again writes, I will give thanks to you, O Lord my God, with all my heart, and will glorify your name forever. Now again, the way we typically do this is by praying to God and giving him that praise and glory there, as well as singing of him in our praise, by speaking of him or to him the things that are true of him, the things that he has shown us in these different areas we've just looked at. We are to ascribe to the Lord the things that are true of him, even as we heard in our call to worship in Psalm 96, verses 7 through 9. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy attire. Tremble before him, all the earth. The first way we are to glorify the Lord is with our words. Glorify him in worship. As often as he gives us the opportunity to do this, in our personal times of devotion, and also when we meet together, we are to glorify him, honor him, worship him, praise him, ascribe to him the things he has done, the things that are true of him. That honors him. A second way we can glorify him, of course, is by living as he calls us to live so that others might see his glory in our lives. Remember the thing that makes God most glorious? And that is his holiness. But that is exactly what he gives to us through the Holy Spirit, through the work of the Lord Jesus, that we might be like him. Jesus tells us in Matthew 5, verses 14 through 16, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Notice here he says the light that emanates from us is essentially the good works that we do for the Lord. And again, good works not for salvation, but for sanctification, what it is that God saved us to do, which is to do good works, that we would be zealous for good works. Even as God's glory shines as this radiant effulgence, here Jesus is telling us that the good works we do in which we behave as he behaves or as God would behave shines from us like light, that men may see it and notice what the result of it is, that they may glorify your Father who is in heaven. If we live the way the Lord calls us to live, others can see his glory shining from us and give glory to the Father. They're not all going to do it. Some of them are actually going to hate us. Jesus tells us that that's the case. But this is the only way that we'll be able to bring others to actually, to the Lord and to worship the Lord, is if we live as Jesus lived. We saw a few weeks ago that the Lord gave us his Holy Spirit in order to make us like him, so that we would live like him, so that we would show the world what he is like, so that we would show him the glory of the one who actually dwells in us. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 and 20, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Live consistently with what it is that's inside of you, which is the Holy Spirit. Don't take the members of Christ and join them to a prostitute. Instead, glorify God with your body. You are a temple of God. Give him glory. So we give glory to God, secondly, by living the kind of life he calls us to live. And then thirdly and lastly, showing the world his glory by the way we live is particularly important when we seek to honor him. The third way, by pointing others to him. And this is perhaps the most important way that we can give glory to God, and that is when we draw attention to him, when we try to direct other people's attention to him, to the things that he has made, You know, maybe we call that apologetics in a certain sense. God made these things. These things all reveal that God exists, and pointing them to the glory of God in the creation, which all men can see. Perhaps a little bit more difficultly, we could point to the providence of God and how he's working all things together to advance his kingdom. But that also reveals the glory of God, and we bring glory to him and we point other people to what he is doing in providence. But we particularly glorify God when we point them to what God has done in Jesus Christ in the work of redemption. That is where God's grace and mercy and justice, as I've said before, are all revealed at the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. We need to point people to him in order that they might be reconciled to him, in order that they might see the glory of God and, through the grace of Christ, actually be led to give him glory as well. Now again, think about the importance of how we speak and what we speak and how we live to this last part of giving glory to God. We want to make sure that we do not negate or undercut the message that we are bringing to them by living a life that is completely inconsistent with the message that we're bringing. If we want to give glory to God, we have to live as Christ before them and share that message of Christ with them in the hopes that God will have mercy upon them. So let's remember first today why it is that the Lord made us and we're a part of this creation, why he revealed himself to us, why he saved us, why in his plan he works everything together for our good. The reason wasn't for our personal comfort. The reason was for his glory, that he might receive glory, that we might give him glory, that we might live for his glory, that we might point other people to his glory. Now, we're going to see this evening that we don't lose out in this deal by any means. Even though God has essentially done all these things for us so that we might give glory to him, that's not a drudgery, that's not a burden, that's not putting us aside. That's the reason why we are as blessed as we are blessed. That's the reason why we have the joy and the pleasure that we have, is because the Lord has planned to use us to give him glory. This is why the Lord has done what he has done in our lives. And so let's be encouraged this morning, first of all, to remember that, and then to do the very best we can to give him glory in our worship, in our lives, and particularly in pointing other people to that glory that shines, that glory of God that shines from the face of our Lord Jesus Christ in the gospel. May the Lord help us to give him glory. Let's bow for a moment of prayer, shall we? And as we do, let's also prepare ourselves to come to the table where, again, we see the glory of God, the glory of his mercy and his grace in these elements as they represent Jesus and what God has revealed to us through Jesus.